Hey everybody, we're going to just jump in on this song. This is Up a Lazy River, and we're going to start on the piano. Follow along on your music.
Sun lingering in the shade of a kind old tree. Throw away your troubles, dream a dream of me. Up the lazy river where the robin song, two bright lights as we stroll along, blue skies up above, the one I love. Up the lazy river, how happy we will be, mama, yeah. Yes, up the lazy river, put it to this by one. Baba, 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 yes. My river is evening. Yeah. Up the lazy river. Oh, you river. You river. Oh, you dog river. Look out there, Billy Kyle. Modulate, Daddy, modulate.
Sorry, wrong tutorial. Hey, everybody. My name's Jason Valleau, and it's a real pleasure for me to be talking to you today. I'd like to thank CADME for putting a bunch of professional musicians together to make some videos so that you, the watcher, the viewer, has some reference and can see somebody with some musical experience, and maybe you can catch a few tips and tricks here and there. I am a professional musician in the city of Calgary, Alberta. I predominantly play this big instrument here, the upright bass, professionally. But I am the son of a band teacher. And sometimes when you're the offspring of a band teacher, you are encouraged strongly to learn other instruments. So I grew up with some piano lessons, and then I did some guitar. I play a little ukulele. And my wind instrument, my band instrument, is the clarinet. I went to electric bass and then eventually the upright bass, and I guess that's kind of my musical story. I started with old jazz, traditional jazz, which we're going to talk about today, but I went into rock and roll. I've been in a heavy metal band. I studied jazz, but I also went into folk music, and recently I've joined a few country bands. So as a rhythm section person, so that is piano, that's guitar, that is bass, any sort of bass, that is banjo, ukulele, anything that sort of accompanies and supports a horn player, a horn ensemble, a singer, whatever, a soloist of any sort, that's sort of my history and my speciality. So we're going to talk about three main focused areas today, okay? Number one, I'm going to give you a very brief history of jazz, the beginning of jazz, traditional jazz, where it started, when it started, and some of the things that went along to sort of bring it where it is today. We're also going to talk about the instruments of the rhythm section and how you play together. And I'm going to use old jazz, traditional jazz, as an example of how we should be sort of, playing our instruments as one ensemble. I mean, you've got clarinets in your concert band and flutes and trumpets that all play as one instrument. And in your jazz ensemble, you have a trumpet section, a trombone section, probably some saxophones, and each section has to play together as a unit. It's a little bit different for us. All saxophone players have a reed and they have things in common. All brass players have a mouthpiece. With rhythm section, it's a little bit different because there's a piano that has a different function and different linear sort of visualization than a guitar. And the guitar has a chunking sort of strumming motion and picking. The bass is an entirely different sort of instrument where it's the low end and it's plucking singular notes. Banjos, we'll get into banjo a little bit. Another different instrument altogether. And drums, we won't leave out our friend on the drums. I'm going to bring in some conversations about where the drums fit into this, but I'm not going to actually demonstrate the drums per se. Okay, let's look at a little bit of jazz history. So this is section one of this tutorial. And it is a long story. If you really want the full story of jazz and you are looking for a good documentary to take you through the long story of jazz, I recommend personally the Ken Burns History of Jazz. Now, the Ken Burns History of Jazz is 12 hours long. Okay, so not everybody has 12 hours that they can sort of sink into a documentary, but it's a really great documentary and it goes through the full story as deeply as it can. So if you have some time, check that one out. Now, jazz was born in a particular city and grew up in thousands of other cities and other countries around the world, but it was actually born in New Orleans. What I can gather from the Ken Burns documentary, my own readings, and YouTube documentaries that you are watching, I'm sure, a ton of, it's kind of surfaced in the mid to late 1800s. Now, here's a little bit of history. What was going on to the mid-late 1800s? Well, Europe music, and you have to kind of look at European music because the instruments came from Europe. A lot of the musicians that play jazz play on instruments that were made, invented, and played predominantly in Europe for 1,000 years. I mean, you look at European music, it goes back as far as 450 AD, and there was, early music, and then it sort of just, it went along. So in the mid to late 1800s, we're coming out of the classical era and we're going into the romantic era. So very complex, rich harmonies that established chordal and tonal centers and instrumentation of trumpets and trombones and saxophones and clarinets and everything that sort of then made its way to North America. Now, North America had a handful of great composers in the 1800s as well. And some of those composers in the USA were John Philip Sousa. Now, he was a gentleman that wrote marches, okay? So you've got a lot of marching bands at this time as well. And in the mid-1800s, now you can't talk about jazz music and the history of jazz music without bringing up some sensitive subjects because it really did come from people that were of the slave trade. Now, back in the 1800s, there was slavery. And out of slavery, culturally speaking and musically speaking, some great music came out of that. And one of those genres, which we'll touch on a little bit more, was the blues, of course, jazz, and ragtime. Now, those are kind of a few sort of ingredients in the soup, as it were, going on at that time. So the Civil War in the mid-1800s ended in the United States, and this was basically a war of North and South, and it was to get rid of slavery. So in the mid 1800s, 1860, I think around there, the slavery was abolished. And what happened there was you had slaves that were singing blues and spirituals happening. You had soldiers that were marching as musicians that left New Orleans and the southern states, left a bunch of instruments behind. You have Scott Joplin in the late 1800s was playing ragtime music. And it was sort of mimicking brass bands and some marches, but it was starting to take on its own flavor, and it was highly syncopated. So all of a sudden you have syncopated rhythms coming into music and sort of shaping and shifting and influencing other styles of music. Okay, so this is going on late 1800s. Scott Joplin, Philip Sousa, marches, the blues, major component into jazz, into shaping jazz, because the first jazz musicians quoted a lot of blues and were using the blues scale. I won't get into too many details around scales and chords because I'm sure you're taking that in your band classes and your theory courses, and you've got online resources for that as well. But the blues flavor and sound was getting into the ears of the jazz musicians and the spirituals, and they were jazz at the time was a faster music. In fact, there's speculation as to what the meaning of the word jazz is, and it comes from a word that's J-A-S-S. It was pronounced jazz in the very beginnings, and there may have been a word, and you can go down your own rabbit hole on this one online, but there may have been an African word that meant sped up or energized as the word jazz. And that was sort of what they portrayed or what they saw this new music that was coming in on the horizon. Okay, that brings us into early 1900s. In the early 1900s, there were a couple of key musicians that started to bump that sort of jazz feeling that was coming out of the blues and this ragtime music. One of them was a trumpet player by the name of Buddy Bolden. Now, Buddy Bolden, there's only one known photograph of Buddy Bolden, and he was never recorded. So there's no recording of Buddy Bolden at all. But he started to influence a lot of the horn players. So what happened here was the trumpet came to the mouth, music came out. A lot of that music was an embellishment of melodies that already existed. So there were all kinds of melodies going on. Now, we just have to pause for a second. Music was traveling at this time. There were traveling minstrel part theater and part music that were on the road, as it were, in the United States, and in there some ragtime started to come in. So music was shifting around and people were hearing melodies and hearing songs. It wasn't through the internet and it wasn't yet on any kind of recording. It was brought by human beings. Human beings were the internet back in these days. And they were bringing songs from town to town. Well, Buddy Bolden was playing along with some of this stuff and embellishing the melodies. And then all of a sudden there were other horns, maybe clarinet, that started to join in on this ensemble, and they would all play at the same time. Now, sure, there were elements of improvisation, but improvised solos didn't come until later in jazz's history, into the 20s, when the melody would be played, and then the band, horn players would stop, the rhythm section would keep going, and the soloist then would get a chance to sort of embellish even more around the melody. But this wasn't the case in the early 1900s. It was all fairly poly, so there were many voices playing at once. Okay, so that's going on. All of a sudden, you've got Jelly Roll Morton, who is also now playing in beer parlors and beer halls in New Orleans, and also starting to hear and pick up what Buddy Bolden and some of the brass bands were doing, and it started to shape. Now, Buddy Bolden is on record as claiming that jazz sort of came from his horn. Jelly Roll Morton sort of said jazz came from his piano. It's hard now, I think, historians to really find the truth on where it started. I think it's this whole idea that maybe no genre really exists on its own without there being heavily influenced influential people and other genres that have helped shape this music that we know today. So that's kind of the early 1900s. And then all of a sudden, ensembles started to form. And that's sort of where the rhythm section started to get fairly powerful in my mind. Now, sort of in the back kind of power, because it was definitely the trumpet players and the horn players out front, and eventually the singers that were the face of the albums that were coming out and the music and the front of the stage. And you know, we, the rhythm section, have always sort of taken this back seat, but we've always been the accompanists. We comp. So to accompany, you can shorten that down to comp, which is where the word comes for comping on a guitar and comping on the piano. Ooh, there's a nice jazzy chord. So this is going on. We're now into the 1900s. Bands are starting to get together. The first known jazz recording was in 1917, and it was by a group called the Original Dixieland Jazz Band. And jazz was two S's, and then eventually came Z's, or Z's, as they call it down there in the States. And this band played and recorded and toured the countryside. Now, what did this do? This opened up to jazz to wider audiences. And it also kind of, it almost kind of skewed the name jazz a little bit, because later on in history, now we get into 1920s, lots going on, lots of development. New Orleans is now spreading into Chicago, New York. It's getting into, even into Hollywood and into the 20s, mid-20s, late-20s, 30s, swing bands, larger bands, closer to the size of likely your ensemble in your school, your jazz bands, 16, 17, 18, 19, musicians on a stage. They're starting to tour around the States, okay? So these ensembles are going. But what happened then? In the 1930s, it went into bebop, okay? So music suddenly, and this is really condensed, you have to watch a larger documentary to really break down all of the facts that are going on here, but what happened was it started to get commercialized. So swing music was perceived as the musicians that were sort of in the background, the real jazz musicians who wanted to explore harmony and different chords and different solos, saw swing music as a fairly commercialized music, much like, I guess we could say, pop music is today, and country music and some forms of rock. There's a very commercial element to some of it that's sort of accessible to a larger group of people. That was swing as to jazz in the 1930s, okay? And then all of a sudden, a group of people thought, you know, I don't really like all of this big band stuff, and this bebop stuff is getting a little too complex. So I think we should go back and play traditional jazz again, but let's call it Dixieland. So it was a word that was sort of branded onto neo-traditional jazz that happened in the 30s. And that's why I think today there's a little bit of a misconception on the word Dixieland. So I think just between us on this video, we're going to use the word traditional jazz or trad jazz. Phase two, the rhythm section. So it started out as accompanists, as I mentioned, where we comped. We comped for all of these other musicians. And it chugged along like that for a long time, into the 20s, into the 30s. And then all of a sudden there was an independence of the piano and the guitar started to float. They were together, absolutely cohesive in the harmony of the song, but harmony started to get more complex and they started to take on independent roles and they started to solo. Here's a quick tidbit. Actually, soloing on the guitar wasn't a thing in early trad jazz. It wasn't until later and later and later. And actually, one of the most famous guitar players, Freddie Green, if you look up that, that guitar player, never took a solo in his entire career. And he was the guitarist for Count Basie, the Count Basie Orchestra. And that is quite an amazing stat. So he was just playing an acoustic hollow body type of guitar his whole career. So in the beginning, that's how it was. Before we got independent, you know, on our own instruments, we really locked together. And we locked together on something that is not done a lot today, but we locked in on what is, you know, commonly as the quarter note. So this sort of pulse, junk, 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 was played on a piano, chunked on a guitar, thumped on a bass, and swung on a snare drum. And we all agreed at one point that that was our primary role, was for the audience, and it was faster tempos, slower tempos, and that was our role. And then jazz and dancing. This is a major thing that happened, that it's almost like one, it's kind of like the chicken and the egg. Which came first, the dancing or the music? Well, in the beginnings of jazz and trad jazz, there was always dancing going on around this music, and it influenced the dancers, and the dancers influenced the music. And the dancers and the rhythm section have always been connected, because we're the ones that provide the rhythm, and the feet provide the rhythm. We watch the feet watch play to us, and there's always been this symbiotic sort of relationship between dancing and the rhythm section. Okay, so on our own instruments. Now, in the beginning, there was no guitar. There was a banjo. And the banjo was four-stringed back then. This is actually a banjo from 1912. This has been in my family for a long time. My grandfather, rest in peace, was a multi-instrumentalist, playing banjo, ukulele, guitar, trumpet, and saxophone. Very strange going from brass to reed, but this man could do it. He couldn't read a lick of music. Preferred playing in the keys of F-sharp, G-sharp, all the black keys of the piano, because he just thought there was less notes. Where's my drummer when I need it? So the banjo was the primary chunking rhythm stringed instrument back in the beginnings of trad jazz. Why? Because it was really loud. It could cut through. It was part drum. You can see there's even a little drum down here. The strings are metal, okay? I'm actually playing the song right now that we're going to be doing together on this video, which is called Up a Lazy River, okay? So the banjo was first on the scene and then later replaced by the guitar. Now, here's another very important thing to consider as a rhythm section person watching this video. We were not amplified, okay? The very beginnings of traditional jazz, there was barely electricity, okay? So there were no pickups, microphones to pick up the instrument. There were no amplifiers on the stage with us. This was all beer parlor, pianos, upright pianos, guitars, banjos, and then guitars, steel string guitars, acoustic guitars. There were not electric guitars, flat, solid body guitars back then, and upright basses. Now, prior to the upright bass, the bass function was tubaed. It was a big tuba that played it. At first, in the beginning. And then the string bass kind of came in. And maybe you can find out and leave me a comment in the comment section on what happened there. Why did all of a sudden the string bass take over for the tuba player? I have a feeling that it's more of a rhythm section instrument. Tubas require a lot of air. And they also, I think, just orchestrally speaking, tubas have a larger sort of melodic role in larger orchestras. And the string bass has always been kind of just sawing these zoom, zoom, zoom notes out. Okay. All right. So we're going to talk about a song. This song is called Up a Lazy River. It's just been shortened to Lazy River. It was actually composed by Hoagy Carmichael in 1930. Now I'm skipping to 1930 because to me, this song is an embodiment of certain chord progressions, which is the third thing I want to talk about in this tutorial. But it's also an embodiment of the second thing we're talking about, the importance and the evolution of the rhythm section to a certain point. And it also is the first thing that we're talking about. To me, it's the end of the trad jazz, and it's now getting into swing, larger bands, bebop, and when jazz starts to go down the road and change and evolve and morph into something completely different. Okay, so 1930, Hoagy Carmichael, Up a Lazy River. The particular recording that I'm interested in showing you is the one that Louis Armstrong recorded with his band in 1931, okay? So he has now developed fully as a trumpet player. He has led the way with his vocal jazz stylings. He was sort of the first one. I mean, there's also some jazz ladies that were pioneers. Bessie Smith and some blues singers that were pioneers in taking blues to another level and jazz to another level. But it was Louis Armstrong that sort of started that whole scat singing, where you're not actually singing a word. You're kind of doing a bit of a mimic of what maybe a horn would sound like, and you're singing a solo that doesn't have words, and you're kind of going around the chord changes and that, and it's pretty cool. So that was Louis Armstrong. So Up a Lazy River, if you bring out your jazz hymnal and turn to page Up a Lazy River, there is a link somewhere around here and a document that you should have, or freeze the screen now. And do a screenshot of that chart, then you've got it. It's quite simple, okay? And this is going to get into the third thing that I wanted to talk to you all about in this tutorial. And it's a very important jazz chord progression, but I do believe that the dominant chord, so the five chord, we'll talk about that in a second, and having many of those in a song that are all major chords and dominant chords is a thing of the past and kind of comes out of this trad jazz era. And after that, they started to minorize, is that a word? Turning the chords into a minor chord. But in the beginning days of jazz, they were all major chords. Now, you might be able to argue, yeah, there wasn't nearly as many sophisticated modes back then. Maybe that's a way you could put it. But you could also say, but they were all major third chords. And you didn't just play one scale over all of them. You had to alter, especially the third degree of each chord, to a major for every chord. I think having that constant dominant, major dominant sort of chord feel opens up a whole new can of worms on what your ear starts to hear, okay? And forcing yourself to have that major third in every chord is quite a thing. So, going to your jazz hymnal, to Up a Lazy River, I'm going to skip the intro. I'm going to go right into the A section. We're going to do an A and a B section. We're not going to worry about the introduction that Louis Armstrong did. And I'll loop this a little bit in a bit here. But I just wanted to start it off. So you're listening for this. This is an E7 is the first chord of the tune. Okay, we're in the key of G. So somehow in the key of G, we're going to get to this E7 chord. And we'll kind of go this tempo. It's two bars of each chord. We're now on the D7 if you're watching along, following along. There it is. So this is coming to the end of the A section. Now we're on the B section. Back to that E7. A7. Now here's a C and a C sharp diminished. We'll talk about that after. Now it's the same stuff, just two beats per chord. One more time, hey! It's almost like a tag. Look up tag. There's the whole song, okay? Now on the guitar, you'll notice the guitar players, now, and everybody has to listen to this, okay? And this is very important because I think we get fairly centric. I think we get fairly focused on our instrument, and we're listening to music. Oh, I play that. I'm going to listen to that. And that's great. And you, as a young developing musician, you have to breathe, eat, sleep, and think and dream about your instrument all the time, because it's how you get better. But you also have to let in the knowledge and the experience that you're going to get by listening to your sphere of sound, okay? So the guitarist has to be listening to the piano. Absolutely, you're in a similar range, you're playing similar notes, you're playing, well, most of your fingers here and all of them over here. The bass player has to know what's going on with the left hand, at least, of the piano player. You've got to make sure you're playing the right chord. You got to make sure you got the right rhythm. The bass player has to watch the left hand of the guitar player to make sure they're in the same planet as well. And I'm just going to put pause on that for a second, too. You will, in your career as a rhythm section person, you will never be bound to just one genre if you, A, like other genres, or B, need a gig. Because a rhythm section player can play in a jazz band, can play some classical if they're trained and serious about it and love it. Folk music, country music, rock music, punk music, heavy metal music. There is a need for a rhythm section player in all of these kinds of bands and genres. So you have an advantage. If a bass player knows the chords of the guitarist and, you know, you're in a garage band, you're in a rock band in the garage, and there's no chart in front of you, like you being the band person that you are. You know how to read music. You're already ahead of the curve a little bit with just the ones that want to express themselves in a rock vein. I'm not saying all of them, but I'm guessing that you've got a little bit more. And that's fine. So you're in a garage and you're watching the guitar player and they're like, do you know this one? And you say, no, I don't. Oh, well, maybe we can't do it. Then you can say, no, play it. I'll watch because I know how to play guitar chords. This is such a handy thing for you to have. Also, I played on a cruise ship. Upright bass on the high seas around Asia. The piano player was a friend of mine, a Russian piano player, so good, knows every song. I would have been completely humiliated and gone from the bandstand if I didn't know a little bit about piano and be able to watch the piano player's left hand and see, oh, he's pointing to the roots of these chords for me to learn it once through. So then on the second one, he changes inversions and I have to know that song. So there's all of these things that you need to know around you from being able to play and knowing what everyone else is doing. So I just kind of explained things on the guitar. Those were the chords. Guitarists, you also have to know the shapes of your chords. And I'll keep a click somewhere here, there, here. We're going to give you the shapes of these chords. Now, there's an E7 here. Yep, there's an E7 there. Yep, there's an E7-9 there. Yep, there's all kinds of E7 chords. I think your best bet is to find something that feels comfortable. And it's not going to feel comfortable at first. None of this will feel comfortable at first. You just have to tell that voice in your head that it will get better and you will feel more comfortable and you'll start to groove and you'll start to feel, see, hear, and experience music on deeper levels the more you stick with it. I think that the less shifting, the better. So I'm going from an E7 here to an A7. I know what a D7 is because I know what an E7 is. Don't tell the piano players, but the bassists and the guitarists can cheat. Because we know shape, and we'll just go down to, oh, there's my D7. Piano players can't do that. There's a lot of other stuff they have to worry about that we don't have to worry about. So there's my D7, because I know my E7. And then my G. Now, I want to just pause here for a second. We are now at home base. We're on the tonic. We're on the root. We're on G. I don't think that you should play just a G, because it's pretty... I don't know, it's just less jazzy. And you know, and the more things you add to jazz, the jazzier it gets and the more complex it gets. Now, a major 7 chord doesn't seem to fit this song. For some reason, major 7 chords don't really fit all of the music from the trad jazz period. But a G6 chord is a safe chord. It's a G, an E, and then there's going to be a major 3rd in there, the B. And then the D, which is the 5, okay? It's that E. It puts a little bit of spice, but it doesn't make it too spicy. This, yeah, it gets pretty jazzy, that major 7. And you're going to use the major 7 a lot in your career. But for right now, let's just stick with this G6, okay? So there's all those chords as close as you can. The C, I'm using a C6 there as well, because I don't want just a C. And I don't want anything complex like a C major 7, not in trad jazz. I don't want it to get too complex. And that's something about jazz music, young jazz musicians. We all, and I'll put myself in there because I was a young jazz musician, we want to overcomplicate things because we think it's going to make it sound hip and more intense and more complex, which therefore we lose people. If we lose people, yeah, then we achieved it because it's jazz and it's supposed to be cerebral. I don't agree with that. I'm agreeing that with that less and less as I get older. You want to bring people in. Why not give them a C6, okay? And then the C sharp diminished. I'm doing this shape, which could be that. If you go up 4 notes, it's the same chord. Look into diminishes. I'm not going to stop. We don't have a lot of time, so, you know, diminish is a whole nother thing. And then it goes to that G again. Up a lazy river, how happy we'll be. Up a lazy river with me. Guitar. Got it? Okay. Let's move on. Let's go to piano for a second. On the piano. Oh, my gosh. Look what I've got. Piano cam. All right. So, I'm going to show you my piano cam, but I'm also going to show you... This is my computer screen, and I'm running a program called Cubase. And I'm telling you, bringing in your music into some sort of DAW, digital audio workstation, allows you to, here's the song, here's the Louis Armstrong song. If I'm just playing, here's a few bars. You see how it's a left and a right? This is the track. I brought the track in so that I could then lay down the guitar part on top of it. I put the bass part on top of it, and I put the piano part on top of it. This is just a really great way for you, for me, for a musician, to workshop music in this new digital realm, this new digital age, which is fantastic because you really do have so many tools at your fingertips that Louis Armstrong had a horn, okay, and then a band and his voice. They didn't have what we have. And I think we owe it to them to really go back and and pay tribute to this and really study up on it. Okay, so let's look at that again. There's the piano. There's the piano there. Here's my G6. Okay, so I'm kind of doing like, maybe I'll do a third and a fifth with my right hand, and I'll do a root and a six. Remember, because this is a six chord, the first one. All right, so the top of the song, if you'd watch along, please, in your jazz hymnal to Up a Lazy River, everybody's got to watch this. Piano, bass, guitarist, and drummer. You got to know where we are. Okay, so Up a Lazy River. I'll slow it down just a little bit, okay? Now, piano player, I'm not going to get too much into your voicings, but just know that the word voicing means you have 10 fingers, and this piano needs to know where you're going to put them, okay? And you have lots of options. I'm not going to go full on chord with both hands. I'm going to kind of do a little, you know, jigging around here to make sure that I'm covering all of the notes. Like, I probably didn't need to double up on the seven, on the diminished seven, but I did. There's the E7, A7, D7, G, E7, A7, D7, and G. There's the song. You'll notice I kept it in here. Boy, looking at my hands on a piano cam, you really see little hobbit hands. I see hobbit hands. It's kind of funny. Anyways, that's the power of music. You can have some fun with it. So that's guitar or piano. You can see that I'm in one range. I'm in one spot. You can open it up. You can have wider voicings. You can have closed voicings, open voicings. You should look up voicings. You should get a book on voicings. You should really look into, and I would suggest that you look at, you know, what this voicings book tells you about 1850 voicings and 2019 voicings and everything in between, because every voicing is going to give you a new flavor, a new direction, some kind of new sound that you haven't heard. And I just, you know, I don't know if you need to put a 2019, 2020 voicing in an 1890 voicing. Maybe if you're trying to invent something new and you're on this creative path and you've got a grant to like fuse the beginning and the end together, great. But I think if you're going to, you know, be true to the art, you should try and learn each sort of point on the timeline. Bass. Let's talk about this. I'm going to have to yell a little bit because my mic's over there. Bass, you're going to do the same thing. You're just going to thump out quarter notes. You're going to go with your comrades here, the ones that are with you on the quarter note. You're also going to pulse on a quarter note. You could also do a two feel once in a while, which is kind of lazy river. And that's kind of up to you. But traditionally, the bass player was also playing the quarter notes. Now you'll notice I'm doing boom, 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 boom. That's really a good sort of fun feature about being a bass player, is you sort of outline what chord is coming next. And it really helps the soloist. It helps everybody sort of be like, oh yeah, thanks bass person. You just like showed us where we are. I really needed that because I was lost. So, how happy we will be up a lazy river with me. Okay, now, one thing about a bass player as well, you can do what's called a kick. Every once in a while, you need a little bit of a ba-dum, dum, ba-dum, ba-dum. Every once in a while, a little kick from the bass player or from the drummer, okay, because this can be on your kick drum drummer, or could be a little ghost. It just sort of helps propel that quarter note swing thing forward. You're the one, you guys are the ones that, you know, sort of like push the thing a little bit, remind us like, oh yeah, okay, we're swinging here. This isn't a, it's not straight eights, it's swung eights. So that's kind of what's going on there. Guitar, piano, bass. Now, boy, could talk forever about this. I'm going to get into the electric bass really quickly about on how to make your electric bass sound like an upright bass. Hang on. I'm going to my instrument wall. There it is. All right, here is the electric bass. Everybody's got one in their band room, likely. All right, so electric bass. To become an upright bass player. Now, you only want to, stylistically, you don't want to, you know, play. Yeah, here's some traditional jazz. No, you kind of need to fit in with the whole vibe, and you don't want to be walking and letting notes ring. You notice on the guitar, I didn't let notes ring. I didn't play campfire chords. I muted things. I kept everything in control so that I could sort of open the valve and let the swing come out, right? So it's just this pulsating thing. And you can't pulsate when everything's ringing all over the place. You also didn't hear me play like a lot of sustain pedal piano. You don't want that. In a ballad, absolutely. There are time and place for all your tools. And you know, I can't even remember if I mentioned this, but you know, we weren't electric in the beginning. So now we kind of have to figure out what tools sort of match this trad jazz era. This does not, but you can fake it. Bass players, palm mute. Your palm goes against the back of the strings. And I would recommend, no matter what you hear, you know, we're not supposed to play with our thumb unless we're doing pop slap kind of funky bass stuff. But you can play with your thumb if your palm is muting the rest of the strings, and you need that sort of dead. See, I'm even palming. I'm sort of like muting with my left hand as well. Because you need to thud. Up a lazy river. There's how to fake it, okay? Bass players, you can fake it. Don't do. You know, it's not an aggressive. It was aggressive acoustically. I imagine they really had to like dig into their instruments to get this sound. But I just have a real strong feeling that it wasn't electric, but it wasn't that electric sort of dig that we know now, especially, you know, if you've played rock or pop or funk or anything like that, or country even, like, you know, country blues now is pretty rocking and you're really digging in there and it's electric and the electric guitar player is getting that kind of thing and holding sustain notes. It wasn't like that in trad jazz. I don't even know what the condition of these instruments would have been like. You know, it's not like there'd be a luthier on every corner and somebody to, you know, and valve oil. I don't think there were many Long McQuaids back in the early 1900s as there are now. I think our instruments, our gear is far more advanced. Well, not even advanced, just new and clean and functioning than the stuff back then. And look what they were able to produce. My time here is up. This was a 45-minute tutorial, and I've come to the end. And I had a really great time talking to you. Because believe it or not, even though I'm talking to a camera, I can really see in my mind who you are. I've been to a million schools as a clinician, mostly on upright bass and a little bit on electric. And I know what you're going through. And I know your band room dynamic, and I know some of the repertoire you're doing. And I know also that if you're a young person, you have access to a lot of music, and you probably listen to more music in one day than my little CD Walkman, my little Discman was able to give me in the 80s. So drink it up and enjoy it and explore and check out a million versions. In fact, we might just kind of play a little bit on the way out here. Why don't we? I'll play along on something here. Maybe not electric bass. if you ever join in on a song, come in the right spot. Okay? I'm just coming to the bandstand. I'd come in now. I'm using my thumb.
Yeah.
Because there's a singer. He's telling people to get down, like volume-wise. Folks, thank you so much for listening to me. I am Jason Valleau. If you want more of this, jasonvalleau.com. I'm also on YouTube. I'm doing more and more of this now that the times have changed a little bit. We're all going online a little bit more, and I hope you get something out of this. And I would like to just give another humble thank you and appreciation to CADME, because CADME and band teachers and organizations like CADME are doing everything they can to educate you, the young person, on music and giving you the resources you need and keeping music alive in your school. Because I'm sure you've noticed that band kids are cool.